Hello. In these videos, I'm building up an ident server for Linux using Rust, Tokio 0.2, and Async await. You don't need to watch them in order, but in case you're lost, this is the second part. At this stage, this program listens for TCP connections, handles multiple clients concurrently, and reads one chunk of data from each client that connects. Today, I'm going to experiment with sending and receiving complete lines of data and add code to parse the incoming query. Let's start by looking at this read call down here. Here our client is a Tokio TCP stream. We're creating a 1 kilobyte buffer and asynchronously reading some amount of data into it. The actual number of bytes we were given goes into n. One thing to watch out for here is that TCP stream doesn't actually have a read method. It does implement a trait called async read, but if we look at that, it only has a couple of strange looking poll methods, which I don't want to use either. But if I scroll right down to blanket implementations, I can see it's covered by this extension trait, async read x. This one does have the read method that I want to use, but to get access to it, it's necessary that I either use the extension trait up at the top of my module, or simply include the Tokio prelude. Here I've got the use async readx, so I can do read. If I run this and send in a typical ident query, this appears to work fine. I sent a query over here, and it was received over here perfectly. But if you've done socket programming before, you realize there's a problem here. There is no guarantee that you will get all of the data at once. To demonstrate this, let's change this so that we don't read just once. We'll keep reading more and more chunks of data and keep printing them out in a loop. Now, if we do that, we need some way to terminate the loop, and we know that the TCP connection will be dropped when we receive 0 bytes. So I'll check if n equals 0, and that's my signal to break out of this loop. So far, that doesn't make any meaningful change. Yep, that's still working the same. But now I'm going to introduce something else, another small program. This is a rather silly TCP client, which is also implemented using Tokio 0.2. This program is a client that connects to the server and sends a completely valid ident query. What's annoying about it is that it splits the query into 3 chunks, with half-second time delays between each chunk. This means that the query will be delivered over the network in 3 separate TCP segments. So let's run this against our server and see what happens. Here I can see that I'm hitting the read function multiple times. The operating system just gives me the bytes as they arrive. Therefore, if I want to work with the entire query, it's my job as the programmer to buffer this data, appending more and more chunks onto the end up until I finally receive the end of the line. Obviously, this is annoying. I really don't feel like writing this code. I'm busy trying to write an ident server here. Fortunately, Tokio provides a neat solution. It has this concept of framing, where you can convert between a stream of bytes like this and a stream of distinct complete messages. For the purposes of this simple server, a complete message is simply one line of text, a Rust string. Tokio provides a built-in tool for this called Lines Codec. We can wrap this around our TCP stream, and when we do, suddenly our input and output works in terms of complete lines instead of dribs and drabs of bytes. So I'm going to change this code to use framed and Lines Codec instead. Here's the new version. As soon as I get my TCP client, I frame it using the Lines codec, and I'm telling it my lines can be up to 1 kilobyte long. Now, this is a stream of lines, so I can simply call next on it to receive the next line. Since this is all async, I need to await on it. Behind the scenes, Lines codec will aggregate data until it has a complete line to give us, and then our code will get woken up with the result. For now, I'm still just printing out what I receive. Let's test this out against the annoying client I showed earlier. Very nice. Even though sending the query was spread out over time and multiple TCP segments, our code in handle client only got woken up when the complete line was ready. We're making progress here. The next problem is that printing out the query is not very useful. What I really want to do is parse it into two U16 numbers, the two ports. Let me add that parsing function real quick. I've added the parsing code as a regular non-async function down here. If it parses successfully, it returns the two numbers. If it doesn't, it returns some sort of error. I'm being fairly lazy with my errors here. Notice that I'm using a boxed DIN error, which lets me mix and match different error types. It's really convenient, but it's going to cause a problem in a minute. First, let's confirm this parser works. Wonderful, let's manage to extract the two numbers. Next, I want to handle the error when I can't parse the message. According to the spec, I'm not supposed to just disconnect, which is what's going to happen here. I'm supposed to transmit a specific error message back first. Let me add that code now. This is looking better. Either I successfully get my two ports, which I store here in local port and remote port, or I hit the error case. When I get an error, I now send a message to the client. I first repeat the invalid query back to them and follow it with the error string that the protocol requires. Sending and flushing a message is an async operation that takes time, so I need to await here. Right, let's try to build it. Unfortunately, my code doesn't compile anymore, and also this error message is huge and scary. It's also kind of misleading. It points to the spawn function up the top, which is not where the problem actually is. But there is a good clue here. It says the trait send is not implemented for DIN standard error. What it's actually complaining about is this situation when the parsing fails. We have the error result here on the stack. Next, we're going to send a message over the network, which requires us to await. This code is going to pause executing while that happens. When the send finishes, our task will be woken up again and scheduled onto a worker thread to continue where it left off. Now, what if we're on a different worker thread from the one we were on before? We could be. We're using the default multi-threaded Tokio executor. This means if we have any variables in scope when we await, they must be send, or Rust won't allow it. So the real issue is that my DIN error, returned by my parsing function, is not guaranteed to be send. All of the real errors actually are send, but that's not good enough. I also need to express it in my trait bounds. The obvious thing to do is add plus send. Let's try that. The trouble is that this produces a bunch of new compilation problems, where my errors are not being magically turned into boxed errors anymore using the try operator. I was pretty confused at this point, so I went to get some help from the Rust user forums. Thankfully, Alice sorted me out. She suggested that I specify both send and sync. Thanks, Alice. I'll add sync there. It doesn't actually matter to me whether the error is sync or not, but the trait implementations that I'm relying on from the standard library only work if you specify both. Once I make that change, I can compile. So now, in theory, my code is working. I can hopefully send a valid request. Great, it's passed it out, and then my connection got dropped. I can also send an invalid request. It sends me back an error message as required, and the connection gets dropped. Wonderful. By the way, you may have noticed something a bit funny about the format of the message that I transmitted. It ended with a carriage return character, but not a line feed. That's because the lines codec will append the line feed automatically. But the ident spec requires me to have a carriage return character too, so I provide that one myself. That's as far as I'm going to go today. In the next video, I'm going to make this server actually respond to the query. That will require me to run an external command asynchronously and process its output. So that's what I'm going to do. Until then, cheerio.